I've learned that the key word is patience. I am full of so many creative ideas that they're constantly coming to me. And I always knew I wanted to create a skincare line. Having worked at Sephora and worked with so many skincare lines when they first launched, like Paracone, Dr. Murad, Anastasia, like we launched them all at that age. And I had a passion for that. But I have found, you know, I have fitness products that I still want to do. I have children's books that I love and I want to write. But I've learned that it's just about, there will be a key time in your life where everything comes together and it evolves from there. Welcome to Empowerista, a show dedicated to helping you show up and be seen as an entrepreneur. I'm your host, Alex Worley, the CEO of Empowerista, an award-winning producer and national TV host, seen on platforms like Entrepreneur.com, Amazon Prime, and Business Rockstars. These are the tips and truths to amplify your influence and income. My guest today is Christine Bullock, the founder and CEO of Kayo Body Care. Christine has been featured on various media platforms for her fitness, nutrition, and beauty expertise, including as a model on the cover of Women's Health, as a trainer and judge on Netflix reality show Fit for Fashion, and as a regular expert on E!, Bravo, NBC, VH1, Hallmark, and many more. Let's learn how she's turned her expertise into a business, collaborated with powerful women like Brooke Burke, and overcame the major obstacle of buying out a business partner. Thanks for being here.
I'm so excited to be back.
Yes. We just realized it's been like 4 years.
I know. So much has changed for both of us
so
in that time.
Much.
It's great. Evolved.
Yes. Well, for those who are just learning about your story, if you could give us an overview of your entrepreneurship journey, because it really started with you as this fitness expert and personal brand, and you slowly incorporated different revenue streams. So give us a little bit of an overview.
Yeah, I think, I mean, this is almost two decades now, if not longer, because I was always passionate about fitness and about movement. I think I started ballet at 3 years old. I was dancing for 17 years. When I went off to college, I went to massage therapy school. I became a yoga instructor at the same time, but always kind of thinking those were like side hobbies. And then when I graduated from school, during school also, I worked in the beauty industry. I worked for Sephora, one of the first Sephoras in the United States, not to age myself. And I was there for like 5-6 years, and I was one of their national trainers, training the new employees in skincare and cellular health and beauty and all of that. So I always had this double life in like beauty and skincare, I think, wellness, and then in fitness. And it just evolved. I mean, I had jobs traveling all over the world working with doctors from Eastern to Western medicine. I had jobs in LA working with all the plastic surgeons and going into surgery with them while still training on the side. And eventually I just realized I wanted to get to these clients that were interested in plastic surgery and beauty and this and that beforehand to find like this inner beauty and this inner health and also take care of maybe the surgery that they've had. And so I went back into fitness full time, grabbed tons of certifications, nutrition came along with it. Then I had all my pregnant clients, so I became a pre and postnatal specialist. So I prepare women for delivery, one of my favorite things. And I was training a lot. But what my mom made me read Rich Dad, Poor Dad when I was like a little one. And she always taught me about business. And I remember, you know, one of the biggest lessons that I took from him was like the Post-it and the Velcro wallet. And this is, I have not read his book since I was a child. But these were items that were missing from daily life that we needed. And there were also a residual income where you weren't working hourly. So I always had that in the back of my head that I was working hourly, whether I was working for a plastic surgeon, a medical device company, Sephora, as a trainer.
You're trading time for money.
Yes, totally. And, you know, you knew you wanted to expand a family and have more, be a little bit more free with your time so that you could spend that with your, you know, future children at that point. So I was always thinking that creative, like, this product's needed and this product's needed. And then I think it eventually just evolved into products that I had experience with, and that I also found people that helped me to create that business, that growing business.
Yeah. So let's go back to the beginning when you were fitness training. Mm-hmm. And there's obviously a difference between someone who's training in fitness and as a fitness expert who's mm-hmm. seen as a face of this industry and is hired for different TV appearances. How did you translate that to being this media personality?
Yeah, you know what? I don't like being on camera.
Why? You're so good at it.
I am an introvert, believe it or not. But I'm so passionate about what I do, and I truly believe in the fitness programs that I've created, that I knew I needed. I'm from Pittsburgh originally, and I felt like I wanted to share that information with people all around the world, including like my family back in Pittsburgh, my friends back in Pittsburgh who don't live in Los Angeles and have that expertise there. So I knew that I needed to get like on-camera experience. And then I fell into like fitness modeling. I literally fell into it. My first job was P90X packaging. But I think when you're passionate about something and you pursue what I thought being a trainer would not make me any money. But I was so passionate. I was like, I just have to do this. I have to quit the big paying job in medical device and I have to go back to being a trainer. which is great, you know, but it evolved into such a bigger business for me with all of these added incomes, because when I was so passionate about it, I kept sharing it in all of these venues.
And people see that, especially mm-hmm. when you're in the LA area where there are so many media decision makers mm-hmm. and it's just obvious that somebody's so passionate about it and they're good
it's
on camera.
True. Yeah. It's not fake. And I think we even see that on social media when we're connected to somebody that we see is so earnest in themselves and versus somebody that is trying to be something else, you know?
Yeah, so I think the key takeaway for anyone watching or listening is if you have this passion, live out the passion, do the thing that you want to do, share it on social media, and people will start to take notice. Not to say that you just sit back and be passive. I'm sure that you proactively eventually were reaching out to people or at least had an agent probably to do that for you.
Yeah.
How would you say that you made a lot of those connections for those media appearances?
Yeah, I did. Eventually, I had a modeling agent, and then eventually I had a manager who connected me with like the TV show that I shot over in Asia, and a lot of the bigger opportunities came that way. I have a PR agency that I think I started with even before doing hosting, so I would write for magazines and meet with them. But I think once you start making the contacts, and then obviously you are a hard worker on set. They see that, and they just call you back naturally. So
yeah,
kind of evolves, you know.
I love that you were writing for articles because mm-hmm. I think the key is just what are the avenues, the platforms that you can contribute to, share your voice, share your passion, your expertise, and it all kind of flows from there.
How can you help other people exactly mm-hmm. and what their jobs are too? You know, it makes it easier on them, I think, on the writers. Like, I have a topic for you, and I would write a bunch of topics and send it out and see which pieces got picked up.
Yeah. So do you think that doing the one-on-one training and trading that time for money, that period of your business and career was very necessary to
absolutely.
Influence where you are today?
Oh, absolutely. I still love it. I still do training. Like, I shot fitness videos on Friday. So I'm still, you know, I'm almost 40 and I'm still doing that from when I started at 19 years old or so. And because I've worked with so many women and men, but specifically geared to women, I've worked from, you know, the age of like 10 years old up to like the 80s, from professional athletes to the novice, that you learn, you have a personal bond with somebody, so you learn what they're looking for, not only in fitness and in body and in movement, but in a lot of other portions, especially in the wellness industry in their life. And what creates like a healthy body and a healthy mind.
Yeah, it's the best education to get to know your audience, mm-hmm. get to know your process, so then you can package that into maybe a more scalable product or service.
Yep.
So was there a specific time? I know that you were inspired for your future family, but was there a specific time that you went, okay, now's the time that I really want to create more scalable revenue streams?
No, I think I've learned that the key word is patience. I am full of so many creative ideas that they're constantly coming to me. And I always knew I wanted to create a skincare line. Having worked at Sephora and worked with so many skincare lines when they first launched, like Paracone, Dr. Murad, Anastasia, like we launched them all at that age. And I had a passion for that. But I have found, you know, I have fitness products that I still want to do. I have children's books that I love and I want to write. But I've learned that it's just about, there will be a key time in your life where everything comes together and it evolves from there. And so with the skincare industry, it just kind of came together for me at a time. And it was the perfect timing. And yeah. Preparation and timing.
Yeah. So what was it specifically for Kayo Body Care that you felt like it was the right time?
Yeah, it was funny. So working with clients, especially the pre- and postnatal clients, and I had become this expert learning from a doula and yoga and all that. So we were really getting into pregnancy and post-pregnancy repair. That's when women really start to notice their body. Now a little bit more with social media, I think, but we notice the changes, and we need an effective skincare brand for our body as much as we're using for our face. And there just wasn't one on the market. And I was looking for one, being a fitness model, wearing a bikini all the time, being in my 30s when most of the models were in my 20s. Like, I noticed a difference changing in my skin all over my body. And I tried it, and it wasn't there. And so what better to fill a hole in the market? Mm-hmm. And at that point, I had a friend of mine. She was the wife of one of my husband's friends. And I knew her. You know, we've been to tons of events. And she came up to me, and she said, she's a lawyer, and she's like, I don't know if you know, but my family owns a skincare lab, owns skincare brands. I had no idea. She's like, I can't find a body care on the market. I was like, me too. So we just, literally, it was that conversation. The next day we met, we talked about it. We worked out some contracts right away, and we started with Kayo.
Mm-hmm.
So I just think it was like, it was about the patients, me very much creating that energy because I was really thinking about it at that time. How can I do this? But then the perfect kind of like
the
combustion
of the
came along.
Puzzle came mm-hmm. together.
Yeah.
And then I know that recently you did break up and buy out your business partner.
Yeah.
Which
very amicably though.
Yes. Yes. So tell us a little bit about that. How is it working with a partner? And then at what point sometimes do you feel like, okay, this served its purpose up until this point, and now it's time to kindly part ways?
Yeah, I think it's great. I mean, I have run a business on my own in the sense of the fitness portion of it for so long that I was always like, I would really love like a business partner to run all my ideas, to assist. And I did. It was great working with her and creating the business together. And I have to say, we were friends beforehand, but I'm glad that we didn't come into this as friends because I think it's so hard. Even my husband and I try and work with each other sometimes, and we just kind of butt heads because he's tired or this. There's a lot more emotion that plays into it when you're so emotionally bound beforehand, I think. Mm-hmm. You know, we really came into this as professionals together. And we did great things. We won awards right away and have amazing formulations and launched everywhere. But over the few years and the time, I think that we just kind of maybe had different ideas. There's a financial split that is like who wants to put in how much money, and then what does that equal to how much time you're putting in. You also have to, I always say to business partners before you get in, write what your jobs are. Because I think I had more of a fun job. I mean, I'll say it, like I came in more as the face of, you know, the product line. Yes, I was formulating and I was working so much on the back end, but not as much operations, and that was her responsibility. So maybe it wasn't as fun. But we just learned, you know, luckily it was very amicably that she was like, yes, you know, totally buy me out. And I got to take the full responsibility. And in learning that, I think it's, for me and my personality, easier to hire in a great team that can now do all those responsibilities that, you know, she was also taking charge of. And people also with a lot of experience, like decades of experience in those, where we were both kind of learning it together and to get the job done. And then also it leaves it on me to make the master decision on everything, which I like.
Yeah, I can understand that. And you are self-funded, so yeah. I would imagine as you're hiring more people, especially experts in their field, that takes out cash.
Yes.
And cash flow is probably always a challenge. Tell me a little bit about your philosophy and when you know it's the right time to hire somebody.
Yeah. We're very lucky. My husband and I, like, I put myself through college. We, you know, didn't come from much money, very humble beginnings, we always say. So we've worked our cash flow from the beginning where, like, he has a little, then I have some job, you know, then he has a job that grows bigger and, you know, his business grows bigger so that we help to support each other in that. And he's been super helpful with the cash flow from the business that he created. So, yes, you do need that at first, or you don't need it, but it is nice to have that yourself. We are actually just came to a point with Kayo where we were looking into funding. And so we created our pitch deck. I actually started to send it out. I mean, this was just within the past couple of weeks. And we decided to pull back and hold on to it for right now because we don't necessarily completely need it at this point. And where we are evolving with, we're launching 15 new products in the next 2 months. We've already closed, which I can't mention, but a lot of huge stores. And until that launches, I have to give a bigger percentage of my company away, right, for those financials. So we kind of want to wait to see so I can hold on to more of the company. That being said, I think that there's a lot of creative solutions that you can do for a company. Our company we made back what we put in all the time. You know, we started with manufacturing smaller amounts, smaller batches. There's ways that you can creatively do this, you know, with any business. You just really can't launch, like, globally and all over the world and think you're going to need money for all of that.
Yeah.
So it's like slowly portioning the business. And I think it's also the best way because you have to learn from the growth how to take care of that and your retailers or whatever business that you're in.
Yeah, I would imagine it's more of investing in your business at the same proportion and
yes.
rate that sales are coming in.
Yes.
And then the beauty of it is you get to be more flexible and agile and, like you said, respond to what your business truly needs so it's organically growing.
Yes. And, you know, it was many years of not having a salary for me, too. So that was the biggest portion. So I was still earning from my other job. So it is working two jobs. Mm-hmm. I mean, I was still earning from the fitness portion of it, which was complicating my time and taking a lot more time working two full-time jobs. But that was my salary, and a lot of that salary I'd put into there. So I'm living off of a minimal budget.
Yeah, and now do you give yourself a salary?
Not yet.
Okay, so
because we're launching so many products and we're fully going into it that we're even putting more money in at this point. But because of the reputation of Kayo, like, and because of the experts that I brought in to run the company, the president, the operations, the sales, all that, I know that we're going to be able to close all the locations that I want and get that back.
And when you say locations, you mean retailers that you'll be distributing through?
Yes.
Yeah, nice, mm-hmm. nice. Mm-hmm. And I'm glad that you brought up that you work other jobs because because I think so many times we glorify full-time entrepreneur, you're able to make it work, you know. But sometimes just the smarter thing to do that gives you more freedom, gives you more cash to invest into your business is having something else that actually is what supports you. And then obviously, as you said, your husband has businesses as well.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you for sharing that.
Yeah. No, you definitely, I mean, so many women that are, I've met so many entrepreneurs and so many women starting their own businesses, and it is a difficult time at the very beginning because you're taking your time in so many places and typically working another job to pay for this new business. But luckily, I think in my aspect, my fitness brand still helps and supports Kayo as well. So I didn't feel like I was wasting time just for financial, you know, for like a paycheck basically.
Yeah. And obviously you're in a very competitive industry and one mm-hmm. of your competitive factors is you, that you get to be the face of your brand, that you have all this experience, that you are your target audience. You get to leverage your personal brand. What role do you feel like you have as a CEO and being the face of your brand?
You know, I actually formulate all of our products. So we have two amazing labs. We have one in skincare and we have one in supplements and nutrition. I couldn't do it without them because they do obviously provide the feedback like, this isn't going to work, or we need it at this levels, and they're awesome. But I say, this is my list, this is the product I want, and here's our base of ingredients. So I think in that sense, like our formulations, which 50% of them have won awards already, they're the best on the market. Mm-hmm. And it's because of that experience that we're talking about, 2 decades of Sephora traveling the world, working here, working there, trying every product on the market because it was sent. They're such awesome products. And so I don't know that it's my face. Like I said, like, I don't like to be in front of camera or say, like, but I love the science of it. If I could continue to formulate, that's like my favorite thing to do, is create these products for people. And then selfishly, I just want to use them. Mm-hmm. Because I can't, even though the market is so overwhelmed with stuff, I feel that I can't find the product that I want. So I create it.
Yeah. So first and foremost, you have a great product. Mm-hmm. And then on top of that, you get to obviously express your interests and your personal brand. Let's talk about your personal brand a little bit.
Okay.
You are very transparent about a lot of life things. And so, for example, you shared your fertility journey on social media and YouTube. What role do you feel like that plays? Is that more so you just want to help whoever you can? Do you feel like that is a part of your personal brand? Give me a little insight into
Yeah, it's definitely not a... I mean... It is part of your personal brand, but that's not why I do that at all. I feel like when you do have a platform where you're reaching people, and I've had such sweet, kind followers from the minute that I started on Instagram and started building, that you feel like they give so much to you. Even if you're in a group fitness class, it's really funny. Like, you think you're giving one energy out to all those people, but all those people are providing more energy back to you. It's like such a blessing. So it's the same thing with social media, that they've provided so much support for me, that you want to be, you know, you want to provide that for them. And I've heard their struggles in health and all that. So I think it's just, for me, it was just about being honest with it. And in the sense of fertility, we went through, to give a little background, like 8 years of fertility, 5 years of IVF completely failed, 3 miscarriages after that. We did adopt my daughter after the IVF, which we were always planning. We love, we're so happy. And I actually got pregnant naturally now. But I think in sharing all of that journey, when I was going through struggles, they were so supportive. It actually made it so much easier. When I went through miscarriages, I shared it almost days afterwards because I knew women had gone through that, and we can just kind of go through that together and be super supportive. And right now, we just shared that, you know, I got pregnant naturally by chance. And
how many months are you now?
I am almost 6 months.
Oh, so exciting.
We kept it a secret for a while.
Yeah.
But there's so many women that have reached out that my journey has, you know, helped them, or that inspires them because they're going through it right now, or they've gone through it for 8 years now. And so if there's anything in my day more than any of my businesses that I feel rewarded out of, it is like that personal connection with people that you may not even know, but you know through social. It's weird.
Yeah. Well, at the end of the day, you have a service-minded attitude of you want to really, really provide value and help your audience. Mm-hmm. And you know your audience so well, whether it's the skincare that you know that they need or some of the life experiences that they're going through. And that's a beautiful thing about social media, is now we don't just have to connect over our product. Yes, we will do that because it's important, but we also can connect over these other commonalities and relatability points, as you have with your fertility journey.
Yeah. I think if anything, I'm actually not great at sales with our products. You know, whatever comes naturally if I want to share it, but I'm not great at like the influencer kind of stuff that's, you know, knows how to put something on that's kind of being paid for, I guess, you know.
Sure.
I'm just kind of putting information out there. So I don't know if I suffer in sales because of that, but it is what it is.
Yeah, which, I mean, it's interesting because a lot of people are so heavy on the sales side that it's like, okay, you should enter a little humanity and personability into your brand, which I think is harder. It's harder to be vulnerable and personable, but that seems to come so naturally for you. So what role do you feel sales does have in your brand and KO Body Care? how do you approach sales?
I have a great sales team. Honestly, that's really, I hire a team around me. I love sales in the sense of I love talking about my products. I love formulating it. And then once we have it, I love sharing it. Mm-hmm. And so in that sense on social too, it is what I can share when I want to share it. Is what I do. But we don't have like a schedule down like you need to share this product at this point or do this, you know. But I do hire in a team that kind of helps with that sometimes. Not necessarily for like social, but in the sense of broader awareness or maybe bringing in influencers to do that. But
yeah, well, and you genuinely love your products, so you use them and when appropriate
demonstrate. I posted about it this morning, my skincare routine. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. That's perfect. Yeah. Awesome. Well, where can people keep up with you and check out Kayo Body Care?
Yeah, ChristineBullock.com, KayoBodyCare.com, and then Christine Bullock on social media and Kayo Body Care on social media.
Awesome. Easy peasy. Love it. Christine, thank you so much for your time
today. It's so great to see you. Thanks for
having me. Likewise. Thanks, girl.